Good morning.
Good morning.
Our Old Testament reading on this Easter Sunday comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, verses 1 through 6, which you can follow on page 733 in your Pew Bibles. At that time, says the Lord, I will be the God of all the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. Thus says the Lord, the people who survived the sword found grace in the wilderness. When Israel sought for rest, the Lord appeared to him from far away. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have continued my faithfulness to you. Again, I shall build you, and you shall be built, O virgin Israel. Again, you shall take your tambourines and go forth in the dance of the merrymakers. Again, you shall plant vineyards on the mountains of Samaria. The planter shall plant and shall enjoy the fruit. For there shall be a day when sentinels will call in the hill country of Ephraim, come, let us go up to Zion, to the Lord our God. I think we can all agree that's the best sound in the entire world. Our epistle reading this morning comes from Galatians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, on page 201 in the New Testament of your Pew Bibles. So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed to him in glory. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18 on page 144 in the New Testament of your Bibles. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lined with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as they yet did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But as Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them all that he had said these things to her. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Well, I have a few moments to do a little homily today. And as I thought about this time with you on this glorious Easter day, I went back in time, as I often do as I get older, and thought about time of Sunday school class. It was the late 1950s, maybe the early 1960s, perhaps the device I will be referring to will help you more accurately place the story in time. It was a Sunday school class during the season of Easter, and Mrs. Kenny was our teacher. She was a creative soul. The theme of the day was to remember new life in Jesus Christ, and to drive home the story. She had a craft project for us to do. Well, it seemed that she had been collecting these things that looked like Easter eggs. Pantyhose. They come in these things. Now, have I made it myself? This was a new invention, and evidently Mrs. Kenny went through an awful lot of pantyhose. What can I tell you? It was a large class. I mean, there was Barbara, and there was Dawn, and there was Mike and Mark, and there was Lynn, Pompey, and Edna, and then there was this child, this wonderful young boy named Don. He was a sweet, sweet child. Back in those days, people would say he was slow. You remember those days? He was slow. He was mildly retarded. But even before official mainstreaming, the Sunday school class was mainstream. And we cared about each other. And for the most part, at least during that Sunday school class, the children kind of did pretty well looking out for each other and looking out for John. Wow. Well, Miss Kenny brought out all these supposed eggs. And she gave each child an egg. And she said, the theme of the day is new life in Jesus. I want you to see what new life looks like. I want you to go out into the churchyard and find something that you can put into your egg that exemplifies what new life is in Jesus. So the children went out. I think she was taking a break, just keeping an eye on things. And don't you know, eventually she called us all back in. And we presented our egg with our surprise, demonstrating new life, what new life might look like. One of the children, one of the girls, Lynn, who had no fears, she said, I have a butterfly in my egg. And Mrs. Kenny opened it up, and out flew them off. Close enough. Another child had a dandelion, and opened it up, there was the dandelion. Another child found these beautiful little purple flowers, and had put them into the egg. New life. On and on we went. There was one child who put a worm there. When asked why, he said, well, I just like worms. I love children. And then it came to Johnny. And while the other eggs looked a little battered, as they would be with children, a little rubbed up, you know, Johnny's egg was pristine. Some of the eggs had trouble getting put back together and collapsed and slid around. His was perfectly put together. Huh. Miss Kenny took the egg and opened it. There was nothing there. Oh, Johnny, she said, I'm sorry. I probably didn't explain it well enough. I'm sorry. Your egg's empty. And Johnny started to nod and point to the egg and say, empty, empty. And Mrs. Kenny said, now Johnny, you were supposed to put something in the egg that exemplifies new life in Jesus. Johnny was pointing at the egg, empty, empty. Well, that's not what I wanted, Johnny. And he said, empty, empty, and started shaking his head. And he got up from his chair. And he went over to the corner of the room, and there was a flannel graph. You remember those? Most wonderful things in the world. And there was a picture of the risen Lord and Mary and the two Jesus, who had been scourged and beaten to within an inch of his life. Jesus, who had the crown of thorns thrust upon his head, who had his cloak gambled over, who was jeered and spit at, who was hung on a cross by his hands and his feet, whose side was pierced, who had a total physiological meltdown, who could not sustain his own weight, and who died of suffocation on that cross. Empty. The tomb was empty. Jesus, who was taken down by his mother and the women and a few friends. Jesus, who was entombed in a borrowed grave. Jesus, who was embalmed with 80 pounds of chemicals and tied up and bound in that tomb. Empty. Empty. Jesus, who in that passion took upon himself the sins of the whole world, including yours and mine, who was dead and buried for 3 days, he descended into hell on that Easter morning. Empty. Empty. Jesus Christ rose from the dead by the grace and glory of God. Jesus Christ is glorified. Jesus Christ is the risen Lord. Jesus Christ gives us the full assurance of eternal life when in the judgment we deserve eternal death. The mercy of God is established in Jesus Christ. The free gift of grace is won for us by Jesus Christ. He died but did not stay dead. He arose and reaches out to us with his nail-pierced hands and says, I love you. Come and follow me. Empty. Empty. The tomb is empty. Hallelujah.